We'll do a little recap in just a moment. But before we start, Chris, can you lead us in a word of prayer?
That's right. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for this day that you've given us to come here and worship and now enter into a period of Bible study. We pray that you bless us as we open up our Bibles and help us to rightly divide the scriptures. Pray that you'll be with Brother Eric and each of the teachers this morning. They'll have a good remembrance of what they prepared and help us as listeners to take what they prepared and apply it to our lives. And pray your blessings on us in the new year. Help us to be better Christians in the future than we have been in the past. We pray your forgiveness as we make mistakes and ask your continued blessings upon us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Daily Bible reading counts. Brother Chad Ramsey did our gospel meeting, and he alluded to the fact that he worked on these the series of lessons in which we're studying. I called him one time, and I asked him, you know, because they give us a quarterly, and it has like the year's, menu of different lessons we're going to talk about. So I said, well, how long in advance do you work on these lessons? And he says, well, we stay up to date about one quarter. So they have the topics and ideas, but he basically has a pretty good crunch time on how to turn these out. So he said it's about one research paper a week he has to do. So, okay, that's the one he does. That's what I wasn't sure which one he, if he did the book y'all have or he did this book. But that's a lot of work to do. Basically, you think he does one of those every week from what you have. But I wouldn't like to operate under that kind of timetable. Not counting, but yeah. But just a little in ways of recap, if you turn your Bibles to 1 Kings 17, since we've got some new folks in, the quarterly is about Elijah, but you can't really talk about him without talking about Ahab and Jezebel and so many other people. But basically at the end of chapter 16 of 1 Kings, and then when we're talking about the northern kingdom, that's where Elijah did most of his work. But Ahab becomes king over Israel. His dad, Omri, had actually conquered quite a many lands, and the northern kingdom had grown to basically its peak power under Ahab. And Ahab was also a pretty proficient military leader in his own right. So the kingdom was strong considering where it would eventually go after Ahab. But Ahab is appointed king. And then in chapter 17, we see Elijah kind of for the first time, and he tells Ahab that there's going to be a massive drought due to your idolatry and the different ways in which they've done. So this drought lasted several years. So Elijah, he flees after he talks to Ahab. He flees and he goes and he stays by kind of a little creek, and he stays nourished there for a little while. Then he goes spend some time with the widow and eventually heals the widow's child and spends most of the rest of the drought period kind of in that period. And then you see in chapter 18, he goes back to Ahab. Ahab at this point is quite upset with Elijah as proclaiming this drought that's really had negative consequences to the land and the people. So Elijah kind of tells them, they do a little showdown, and y'all studied about that last week with Elijah on Mount Carmel. And you see that Elijah, they do a little sacrifice, and they take the prophets of Baal versus Elijah and see who can light this sacrifice. And of course, the prophets of Baal failed in doing so, and Elijah was victorious when he spoke to God, and God ignited his fire. So that brings us to verse 40, and we'll pick up there. And Elijah said to them, in chapter 18, verse 40, "Seize the prophets of Baal, do not let one of them escape." So they seized them, and Elijah brought them down to the brook Kishon and executed them there. So at the very end of the lesson last week, that's kind of the closing, was that after Elijah and God had proven to be the real God, they executed all the prophets of Baal, and there were several hundred of those. So it's a big turn of events of where the children of Israel had been in that northern kingdom, when they had basically, Jezebel was a very devoted woman to the worship of Baal. She was very committed to that cause, and so as a result, the children of Israel had really went down into idolatry. Not all of them, but a good chunk of the nation had. So let's go to our quarterly, and we're on lesson 5 right now. And it picks up in verse 41 after the events on Mount Carmel. Then Elijah said to Ahab, "Go up, eat and drink, for there is a sound of abundance of rain." And keep in mind, it had been in a drought for about 3.5 years. So they have not had any rain or even dew. And you imagine no dew and no rain, it'd be pretty dry conditions there and a lot of suffering. But you see right here, you see Ahab is the king, but Elijah at this point, after doing what he did, is kind of taking control here and telling Ahab what he needs to do, which I think is an interesting turn of events. So he tells Ahab, "Go eat and drink, for the sound of rain is coming." So Ahab went up to eat and drink, and Elijah went up to the top of Carmel. Then he bowed down on the ground, and he put his face between his knees and said to his servant, "Go up now, look toward the sea." So he went up and looked and said, "There's nothing." And 7 times he said, "Go again." Then it came to pass the 7th time that he said, "There is a cloud as small as a man's hand rising out of the sea." So he said, "Go up, say to Ahab, prepare your chariot and go down before the rain stops you." So again, it has not rained in 3.5 years. There's just a little tiny cloud over in the distance. And Elijah tells Ahab that he needs to get in his chariot and get down from the mountain and get as far as away, because you're about to be stopped by the flood waters. You're not going to be able to go in your chariot. It's going to rain so much. But Ahab does as Elijah says, and that now it happened in the meantime that the sky became black with clouds and wind, and there was a heavy rain. So Ahab rode away and went to Jezreel. Then the hand of the Lord came upon Elijah, and he girded up his loins and ran ahead of Ahab to the entrance of Jezreel. I think that's interesting in 46 here. So Ahab's gone. He's headed his way to Jezreel, and the Lord, I guess, girds up Elijah, and he beats Ahab to Jezreel. So I don't know. I assume that he's running in this. It says that he ran ahead. I think that's probably what that literally means. He ran that fast. Again, we were introduced to Elijah, and he was proclaiming a drought. This is the close of that period in that the drought has ended. The rain has come after all that. In verse 40, we saw the execution of the prophets of Baal. I want to back up and touch on verse 4 of 18, because that sounds pretty severe. Almost 450 or more prophets have been executed right there. But look in verse 4 of 18. "For so it was while Jezebel massacred the prophets of the Lord." Jezebel had actually massacred God's prophets. Elijah alludes to that later on, but there had been a lot of murdering of prophets during this time. But if you look in the Old Testament in Deuteronomy chapter 17, the first seven verses, it talks about the law. There was a specific law for idol worshiper, especially those who were basically priests of the idols. Then the law was that they were to be executed. So Elijah was doing what the law said when those folks were executed. But Jezebel wasn't just, like I said, a passerby when it come to the religion of the prophet of Baal. She was a devoted member of it, and as a result, Ahab was kind of wishy-washy on the whole religion matter, so he left the religious matters up to her, and she was hardcore. You see in verse 19, you see that those prophets were actually at Jezebel's table. She took good care of her prophets. So they were close to her. And she was a devoted member. So you imagine, and we pick up in chapter 19, kind of Ahab breaks the news to her that, you know, your prophets weren't able to start the fire. And in fact, Elijah slayed all of them. So how does she take this news? You know, a wise person would probably take this news as, you know, maybe I'm not worshiping the right people. Maybe my gods are not as powerful and as important as I think they are. But that's not how she takes to the news, and she is just enraged with it. So we'll pick up and read the first four verses in 19. And stop me at any time if you have questions or comments. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, also how he had executed all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah, saying, "So let the gods do to me, and more also, if I do not make your life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time." So you see Jezebel making an oath right here that she is going to end Elijah's life. And they go and tell him that. Verse 3. And when he saw that, he arose and ran for his life. And he went to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah, and left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a broom tree. And he prayed that he might die and said, "It is enough now, Lord. Take my life, for I am no better than my father's." So we see Jezebel so upset. She issues basically a death warrant on Elijah. Elijah is so scared of this, doesn't want to die at that time, flees. And he goes from the northern kingdom to the southern kingdom. Beersheba is actually on the southern end of the southern kingdom of Judah. So he travels quite a distance for that, and I'd say he was making good time on his way down there. But he's tired. He goes even further into the wilderness and sits under a tree, and you can see that just a short time before he was I guess on a high. He had proven to the people, all the nation of Israel, that God was the true God. He set the fire on the sacrifice. He was the true God. But now he's having to run, and he's quite distraught, and he's upset to the point that he wishes to die. He doesn't think, apparently, that he can outrun Jezebel, and his life is soon to be over. So he's very upset and disappointed. So how quickly, I guess, things change. But if you look at, I guess it's about a 4 to 5 day journey from where he was to get to Beersheba. All right. And this is kind of a familiar place for Elijah. After he proclaimed the drought, he had to flee, and then he was alone for a long time by the brook. So here we see him again after doing a great work. He is alone in the wilderness. And I got thinking, you know, after that great miracle that was done, you know, what if that miracle happened today? How would people respond? I feel like people would probably respond in a very similar way to the way they did during Elijah's miracle. There were some people who believed. And they trembled and they believed, and there were some people who were just flat out scared that they had seen and witnessed this miracle on the mountain. But then there were people like Jezebel who, despite the miracle, dug into their own beliefs and were unable to see the truth and the truth of God. So I feel like any great miracle that God would perform today would probably be met with very similar reactions. There would be some that would be converted by that miracle and believe it. There would be some that would just be too scared and probably not do anything. And then there would be some that would find any which way possible to not believe that and to say it's a lie. Okay. And I also thought about, you know, in Jesus' day, there were people who did the same thing. If you look at some of the Pharisees and some of the Jewish leaders during that time, they witnessed Jesus perform many miracles. Heal blind people that they knew were blind. Heal people who could not walk, that they knew for a fact these people could not walk, and now they're running around telling everybody about Jesus. But how did they respond? A lot like Jezebel did. They knew that that was true, but they dug in to find any which way possible to put that down, and for that they wanted to execute Jesus as well. So I think there's some several different examples, and that's probably how we would respond as well in our day. So you see Elijah by the tree. He's in a bad spot, and he's ready to be done. But we find out that God's not quite done with him yet. And we'll study a couple more lessons about him so we know that God was definitely not done with him. But we can do many great things for God, too. We can work hard like Elijah did. But God still needs us. He still needs us to go and do the work that he set forth for us to do, just like he's going to need Elijah to do it as well. So I think that's a good lesson. So let's pick up in verse 5. Then as he lay and slept under a broom tree, suddenly an angel touched him and said to him, "Arise and eat." Then he looked, and there by his head was a cake baked on coals and a jar of water. So he ate and drank and lay down again. And the angel of the Lord came back the second time and touched him and said, "Arise and eat, because the journey is too great for you." So he arose and ate and drank, and he went in the strength of that food 40 days and 40 nights as far as Horeb, the mountain of God. So you see him eating. That must have been a good cake and some good water, because he makes a 40-day journey without eating again or drinking again. But he goes to Mount Horeb. So what do we know Mount Horeb to be? What's another name for that? Mount Sinai. That's correct. So what happened at Mount Sinai? The Ten Commandments were given. What else? There was another event at Mount Sinai, Mount Horeb. Burning bush. So you see that God has, that's a very important mountain for God. And it's really neat, the next little bit of exchange that we'll study about today and then next week. This exchange between God and Elijah, and think about Moses and the exchange from when Moses got the Ten Commandments and Moses and the burning bush. And you see God's presence in both of these examples. So, you know, think about that. Due to that, you know, how long it took them, the children of Israel, to get from Mount Sinai to the Promised Land. It took them 40 years to make that little trip. And it's interesting that it took Elijah 40 days to sprint basically down from the same location. It's a lot of interesting things when it comes to numbers in the Bible, and I think that's one of them. 40 years versus 40 days. It could have happened. It could have been 41. Could have been 42. But no, it was 40 days is how long it took. And all the things that they had saw, they were, their whole being was fed by God through the manna and through the quail, I believe, that you saw that God supplied their needs every day. And gave them water when they needed it, but yet they still turned to idolatry. They were punished for theirs, and you'll see that Ahab and Jezebel's justice is coming to them as well shortly on. All right, let's look in verse 9 right here, and then we'll pretty much be at a close. And there he went into a cave and spent the night in the place, and behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And I think if you're ever going to do a sermon topic, that would be a wonderful sermon, God asking, "What are you doing here?" And we see a little bit of Elijah's answer, and we'll study more about his answers next week. So he said, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God of hosts, for the children of Israel have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they seek to take my life." So go back to that question God asked him, "What are you doing here?" And you see the answer in which he gave. I don't quite think that's the answer God is looking for, because he's going to ask that same question of Elijah next week, and Elijah supplies a similar answer. But what are you doing? You've made it. You're under the tree. You're ready to give up. I fed you. You've traveled all this distance to my mountain. What are you doing? And there may have been times in our lives where we've been distraught. We've been upset. And we've been down. And you can just hear God asking us, and maybe sometimes we thought, you know, what am I doing? How did I get to this point in my life? So I think that's a powerful lesson for us all to take. God's not done with us. He's not done with Elijah. And think about why he put us here and for what reason. And you'll see that Elijah, as he responds to God, he says, I'm alone. There's no one else but me. And again, without getting too much into Chris's lesson, we're going to find out that's not the case. There's more faithful people out there. And sometimes when we feel alone, we need to think about that. And we're not alone. There's other people who are in similar situations, and then there's people there to help. And we need to be those people to help and to reach out to those who are struggling with different issues of life. Any other comments or anything? I tried to shoot through that pretty quick. Our time's about to be honest. When they listen to God. And I was doing a little research on Ahab, and, you know, because we don't hear a ton of positive things about Ahab, which there's not a lot of good to say. But militarily, there were, make sure I get this pronounced correctly here, Shalmaneser. He was one of the mighty Assyrian kings. Assyria was eventually going to be the conquering nation of the northern kingdom. But Shalmaneser, one of their great kings, he come down with a big army, a massive army, ready to take Israel in the northern kingdom. But Ahab was able to unite the forces of several other kings around the area, and they were able to stem back his attack during that time. Bought him a little time. You'll see it doesn't buy him a ton, because they do come back, and that time they do win. The next time they do conquer the northern kingdom, but Shalmaneser did come down ready to destroy him, and Ahab and was able to unite with other kings and fight him back. And how great of a king he could have been had he just listened to Elijah and just listened to God, and how great the northern kingdom could have been. Had Jezebel forsaken her idols and turned to God, she could have used that devotion to Baal and turn that to God, and you would have seen they could have been a good pair. It could have been a good kingdom. And I didn't hit this point, but we got a few minutes. In the Old Testament, you see leaders. You see Moses, you see Joshua, you see the judges, and you see the different kings throughout. And then you see God speaking to these people through his prophets. He kind of goes at the head of the nations. Speaks to them, thinking that maybe try to turn their wicked ways and then the people will respond. Because it seems like so much in the Old Testament, the people did as the king said, which the king had so much power and authority. You see that. And you still see that today in different dictatorships and in different countries like that. You see where the king and the leader sets the religious pace, and then everybody follows after that. But when Jesus came, you don't see him going to Caesar. You don't see him going to King Herod. He kind of changes the structure of the way it was dealt in the Old Testament to Jesus going to fishermen, going to tax collectors, lepers, prostitutes, going to all kinds of people. And through that, he converted, and through that, Christianity changed the world through, I guess, quote-unquote, the common man. I thought about that approach is kind of how that shifted from God speaking to kings, speaking to leaders, and to when Christ come, really talking to the common man and converting them, and through that make great changes throughout the world.
The greatest king in the world ever seen.
By just you and me. It was, how mighty of a battle when King Hezekiah, when the foreign people tried to come in and invade and take over. And it didn't take nothing for them, and they wiped out massive thousands and thousands of those who had tried to attack by just being faithful to God. God took care of them, and He'll take care of us too. All right. Thank y'all very much.